Hi, I'm John Zombro, here with the Lifetime Athlete, and in this video, I'm going to be talking about this topic, understanding gait mechanics, particularly in the foot. So I'm here at the whiteboard, and I just finished up a collegial consultation session with a client, and this is a mentorship service that I provide in my coaching menu to help fellow physical therapists and coaches and trainers to understand these concepts and to get better results with their clients. But if you're also a very curious athlete in regards to how the foot works, how it functions, and how learning these things can help improve your performance and potentially reduce your risk of injury, then by all means, this video is for you as well. So right away, I'll jump into, I think I need to move this way. Apologize my sloppy writing and artistic skills. I fleshed this out as we were in the meeting. And so if you'll forgive me, thank you very much. But first of all, in understanding gait mechanics, we just want to go over some simple concepts. If we view the foot as a tripod, or in other words, where we weight bear on our foot utilizes our heel or our calcaneus, the fifth metatarsal head or the outside ball of the foot, and then the first metatarsal head or inside ball. Those are the points of reference through which most of the forces travel in our foot, at least when we look at its interaction with the ground and force plate studies. So the big elephant in the room, of course, are the terms pronation and supination, but they're really just terms which describe motion. And so this is triplanar motion, in other words, motion occurring in all three planes. And so we've got the sagittal plane, the frontal plane, and the transverse plane. But really, it's a composite plane happening about a unique axis or an instantaneous axis of rotation that the foot is behaving around as it pronates and supinates. So really all pronation and supination are is just describing how the calcaneus either everts or inverts, and then also the motion we have at the talus and the forefoot to either roll in and down or to kind of jack up and out. So that's a very basic picture, but I think that helps you to get the idea. In our gait, we have two major phases, the swing phase when the leg's in the air and the stance phase when the foot's on the ground. That's what we're going to emphasize today. And so in pronation and supination, it does occur both on the ground and in the air. Those motions are utilized. However, most of the things that we're dealing with today are what's happening when the foot hits the ground and then leaves the ground. So first of all, if you can see this corkscrew type of graphic here, when our foot pronates, it lands on the ground in a slightly supinated position. And when we're walking, that's going to be a heel strike. Not so much when running. We'll talk about that in a moment. And then it rolls down and in. Well, that drives internal rotation of the limb. So that spirals up, almost dominoes up our kinetic chain, internal rotation. Now, we actually have external rotation, which occurs just after that. So as the limb is internally rotating, driven by the foot, as the body comes forward, now we have the upper body, the hips, the pelvis, beginning to cause external rotation to occur, which we will utilize in setting up our foot for push-off. So those are the motions. And then I think these terms are really where we want to dive, because if you break down stance and you say, well, early stance would be when we make initial contact until we're at mid-stance and we have a nearly perpendicular tibia to the ground. Then we have late stance, which is past that point as we're preparing to go to heel off and then to toe off or push off. So our early stance, and this is where these terms, we want to make sure that I'm being clear. The foot strikes or lands supinated, so it's in a position that's supinated. But as soon as we make the ground contact, the foot begins, or should in most cases, begin pronating. And so that's really a distinction. Land supinated, begin pronating. And this is a yielding orientation in our muscles and joints. It is coordinated with expansion as a strategy. And this is how we unlock the foot so that we can then accommodate to the support surface and absorb force, get what we call plantar grade or in connection with the ground, but also dissipate that force through torque conversion and other mechanisms. Now, at mid-stance, I could say a lot more things than just we're roughly at max pronation, but that's kind of what we're seeing is the foot has pronated nearly to its full extent. There's some degree of variance there among individuals. With late stance, however, now we have a pronated foot that is in a pronated position, but it is beginning to supinate again, sometimes called resupination, from the heel moving forward. And I've got some diagrams to show you that. So we've got the pronated foot, which is now supinating prior to push off. This is an overcoming orientation, and we use a compression strategy. That allows us to lock up the foot, at least in domino fashion, locking the rear foot, locking the midfoot, so that we now have a rigid lever to push off from or to undergo propulsion. So that's kind of an interesting but simple way to look at what these things happen, how pronation and supination is used in early and mid stance. So I'm going to move on the other side of the camera now. And what I want to show you, first of all, is this purple foot. And that's a really funny looking foot, I realize that. But nonetheless, when we're walking and we look at force plate studies, we will see an initial contact on the lateral heel. That line of loading or force, or the path, will go up the lateral side of the foot towards the outside ball or fifth metatarsal head, and then it will curve over towards the first met head where we want to get that loading. That's our propulsive power. And then the force will go on out the toe. Now, the shape of this line will vary from foot to foot, sometimes left to right in an individual, but certainly between people. And what we typically want to see is we want to have lateral loading in the first portion, the first maybe half of our gait cycle, and then we're going to be loading medially as we are pushing off. You'll notice that I drew that line so that it's not coming off the inside edge of the big toe, but it's already starting to move back laterally, because that's a component of how we want that force to go through the foot. We don't want to be staying in pronation too long, whether we call that over pronation or under resupination, doesn't matter. Now, when you look at this foot, what it gives us is these zones or these lines. So here's where, when we land, we're in the supinated position. That's in the lateral rear foot. Then through this path of motion that we see here, the foot is undergoing pronation, or it's pronating. Now we've got a pronated foot so that we can get on that first med head and big toe to some extent. And then it's starting to supinate or resupinate again as we are pushing off. When you look at running, it's slightly different. And that's because at different speeds of locomotion beyond walking, we tend to not use the heel strike, nor should we as much. And so when we're jogging, we'll usually make contact just forward or on the forward aspect of the lateral heel. More into the midfoot with running paces. And so if you say jogging is an easy warm-up pace and running is the race pace you might use for a mile or 5K, okay, we can go with that. And then sprinting would be the position that your foot's going to use in the 100 meters, for example, some leeway there. But what you'll notice is there's an interesting phenomenon. We conserve energy as humans. And so even though we make initial contact here, we typically set the whole foot down when jogging and running, because it takes too much energy to hold the heel off the ground. We don't need that. And by letting some of that force drift backwards as the foot now makes that flat contact, we can both access our pronatory function and also conserve a bit of energy. So that's why you see these lines dip back with jogging and running. However, with sprinting, again, at the fastest speeds, maybe 10 seconds and under, possibly 15 or 20, depending on the individual, we're going to basically just be striking on the lateral forefoot and then powering right out through the forefoot. So that's kind of what you'll see. And sometimes you can see this in callus patterns on an athlete's foot or shoe wear. And I'm going to talk about that in a different video. So now, if I go down to the blue stuff here, this is a, what I use as an example or a model to explain how pronation and supination are paired in the foot during stance. So we have, let's just say this is a left foot, and then we have two waves of motion that travel through the foot in the gait cycle, just as we pictured here. So our first wave is a pronatory wave, and that's when we make that initial contact and we pronate. And so here would be that left foot seen from the back, there's the big toe. And so the motion or the momentum is going down and in. Then the second wave, or wave two, is our supinatory wave. And that's once we've gotten past mid-stance, and now we're preparing to push off, that foot is starting to pronate again. Now it's being driven by that external rotation corkscrew that the limb is driving, and that's helping us to lock up the rear foot and the midfoot to create a rigid lever from which to push off. We don't want to push off a flexible foot. That can cause tissue stress and or injury. And we also have a unique function of our plantar fascia when we are in the heel off position prior to toe off. We've got that dorsiflexion, we've got the extension of the hallux or big toe and forefoot. And what that does is it puts tension across the plantar fascia. It works as what we call a windlass mechanism, and then helps to tighten the foot, jack up the arch, thus stiffening. So all these things, you don't ever have to think about them in most cases because it just works, or when it works, it's great. A lot of times with athletes, though, we'll find that maybe they've had an injury that they've developed a protective or holding pattern around, so they've changed their gait mechanics, or they have a habit or a position that they use. So sometimes we can tune a person up using some of these basic principles. Now, in trying to get the summary, what I'm going to say is we have two main biomechanical goals when we are talking about what the foot is doing in gait. And it's really this. We need to be able to land in a relatively supinated position and then pronate to the degree necessary. You can't pronate if you're already pronated, so we have to be supinated to pronate. And then how much we pronate will depend on a person's individual anatomy, the shape of their foot, the mobility within that foot, and also the speed that they're moving. And all that's context dependent. But we need to land supinated and then pronate. Next, and finally, number two is we need to be able to push off primarily the first metatarsal head and the big toe to some extent. Now, some people say, you know, we don't want to push on the toe or we don't want to claw the toes. Now, I'm going to agree there in a standing position. However, the faster we run, the more we're going to use everything we've got to create velocity, and that's going to be the big toe contributing to some extent. So we push off the first med head and the big toe with a rigid foot. We don't want a slop-slap noodle, you know, no floppiness in that system, because that's going to be less efficient in delivering power, and it's also going to put our tissues at greater risk. So we want to get that resupination, creating the rigid foot out of the pronating position. One exception to this is in the acceleration phase of sprinting. I'll save that for a different video, but we use slightly different mechanics, or should. So the one thing to finish up with is there's room for individual variance with all of us. But what I like to do is I like to make sure that every clinician that I'm working with in a mentorship capacity, or every athlete that I'm coaching, at least has a basic understanding of this, so that then we can start to apply these principles to how we analyze movement in an individual, how we coach and cue exercises, what's corrective, what's performance enhancing, all of those things. And if you would like to get more into these things, you think you might be a candidate for some coaching, whether that's for performance or as a colleague to get better results for clients, you know where to find me. That's at thelifetimeathlete.com, where we can all become and remain hard to kill on the playing field and in the game of life.